Our panel consists of State Finance Secretary Preston Dorflinger, Sterling Zierley, who is the Executive Director of the Oklahoma Public Employees Association, Dean Mickey Hepner with the UCO College of Business Administration, and House Democratic Leader Scott Inman here at the site. They will, and this is going to be the same for both panels, they will make brief introductory remarks, brief, 3 minutes or so, about their particular issues, and then we will go into my questions. And I'm going to work as hard as I possibly can to leave room for your questions.
Thank you, David, Oklahoma Policy. Thank you all of you for being here today. It's a pleasure to be able to participate. Let's open up with, I think everyone has an appreciation for what the budget process looks like and my role in it. But it's very clear from the Board of Equalization meeting that I have approximately $172 million hole to work with to build the governor's executive budget. At the same time, we know that we received new numbers in February and hope that we pick up some additional revenue at that time. But I don't think this is necessarily a bad thing, because what it does is it forces us to really focus on priorities, and it forces members of the legislature to do that as well as we go through this process of building the executive budget. There are a couple things that are priorities for me, and I've not been bashful in speaking to those areas. We must begin and continue this dialogue on horizontal drilling, and frankly, we also must begin to look at the way we take care of infrastructure in this state differently than this idea of pay-as-you-go. And when we look at a model pay-as-you-go, that causes us to use current revenues on things that could be otherwise used on program areas. So those are a few of the areas that you're going to see us to begin to focus on. And again, with the budget, executive budget facing $170 million shortfalls, you will see us prioritize spending in some specific areas, and that process is just underway with the governor as we speak. And later today, we'll be meeting again.
Next, we will hear from Sterling Zierley with OPDA.
Thank you for letting me be here today. I'm going to take Secretary Dorflinger's time. He's only used a minute and a half, because I'm going to go over 3 minutes probably, but anyway. So I wanted to just kind of talk to you today about the total compensation study that was conducted in conjunction with the governor's office, and also the Cabinet Secretary Dorflinger sat on that meeting with us. It was conducted by Neville Kenney consulting firm out of California, and they used Hay Group information, and they used National Compensation Association State Governments information. We had a great panel along with the governor's chief of staff and her personnel. We had a panel which OPEA was a part of, the Oklahoma Public Employees Association. We had Secretary of Finance, as I mentioned. We had Appropriations Chair, and we had some cabinet secretaries and the Director of Human Capital Management. What's interesting about this study is, you say, why another study? The difference between this one is they looked at the in-depth market within the state of Oklahoma, which was kind of unique, because we've looked at the surrounding states, but they looked at the competitors within Oklahoma, like oil and gas, and we're excited about that. And if you haven't realized it, we do not have a pay philosophy for the state of Oklahoma for state employees. And it's interesting that we run the state like that when you have different agencies paying different amounts, and that was another reason that the study was conducted. And then we had this preconceived idea that the benefit package was rich, and that offset the salaries that should be paid to state employees. So looking at those areas, some agencies have been able to get pay increases in the past because they had financial funding. But what we found was about 22% of the salaries of state employees were below market. And when you looked at the benefits of that and you put those together, the state employees were still about 7.5% below market compared to the private sector. Some of the recommendations that came out of the study was to appropriate $40.1 million and look at people who meet or exceed standards, but specifically target some areas. And David mentioned this earlier, Department of Corrections is one of those targets, social services, nursing and law enforcement, and juvenile services. What's interesting about this is lawyers in the state of Oklahoma, they were significantly below market on salary, but, how many lawyers in here? I don't mean to offend you, but they were significant, but we have three law schools in the state, and so that was interesting because if you look at corrections on the flip side, you have 20% turnover in DOC alone and 27% on correctional officers. So that was one of the reasons we had the targets. Some of the things that we talked about also, they looked at the benefits and how they were structured. But here's what's interesting about the consultant. He said, since the benefit is actually tied to a dollar amount, the consultant made the special note that you would have to increase an employee's salary proportionate to the amount you decrease their benefit allowance to keep the change from reducing total compensation. And something else is interesting, when you see this study, he talks a little bit about the retirement system, but what he's talking about is the amount they put in when you're employed. Right now we put in 3.5%, the average is about 5 to 6%. And one thing I hope I get a question on this, I'm going to preface this, is we need to talk about pension because I have to wrap up, and hopefully we'll get a question on the pension here shortly.
We'll now hear from Dean Hepner from UCO.
Thank you all for welcoming us here today. I was just remarking a little bit before that the last time I talked about state taxes in this room on this stage, I was debating Art Laffer and the income tax cut. And I must say how refreshing it is to be on a panel with a group of Oklahomans who will actually be impacted by the discussions that we're having today. I do want to take just a few moments to talk about some of the challenges that I see for us short-term and long-term going forward. The first is on the budget side. I know that Secretary Gerflinger mentioned the $170 million hole, and that is a significant amount that the legislature and the executive branch are going to have to grapple with moving forward. But I'm actually a little bit more concerned about the tax revenues we collect this fiscal year, because I'm still seeing continued weakness in my economic models, and I'm not certain that we're going to hit the numbers that were just projected even last December going forward. So the state board of equalization projected we would fall about 2.8% below the estimate at the end of this fiscal year, which is well within the 5% cushion that David talked about, and my estimates are not quite so rosy. And I'm still showing us getting really close to that 5%, even 6% shortfall number for this fiscal year with a little bit of a rebound going forward. So I still have that concern for what we have going on this year, and that there still might be that chance for some mid-year budget reductions, especially in that May, June time period going forward. But I also have a concern about a challenge that we have here in Oklahoma, and I call it the discourse challenge. We seem to be talking about the wrong problems too much. We talk a lot about our state's income tax and how we need to cut that state income tax, but you know what? Our state income tax is actually below the national average. Our income tax burden is less than what most Americans pay at the state level. But our sales tax is above the national average. And furthermore, our sales tax is actually an antiquated tax. It taxes the wrong kinds of things. It's not built for a 2014 economy. Going forward. So we talk about tax, our income taxes, when we really should be talking a lot more about sales taxes. Furthermore, we talk about taxes as if cutting taxes is always the best thing to do. But I think evidence shows us here in this city, in this state, and really around the world, that tax cuts matter, but not so much as quality of life matters. So the real role, when we think about what the optimal tax structure should be, I mean, what gives us the best quality of life going forward? And if you think about a world where we just continually cut taxes, you end up in this kind of situation. You think about, well, what would an economy of a place that's populated with unhealthy, uneducated individuals who have to travel down dirt roads populated by criminals, that kind of environment, that kind of low tax, low government environment is not really one that's all that conducive to economic growth moving forward. So I hope going forward that we're able to successfully tackle the fiscal challenges that we face, but we also this year begin to tackle those discourse challenges that continually plague us. Thank you.
And we'll now hear from House Democratic Leader Scott Inman from Del City.
I too want to thank David and Oakland Policy for the invitation to be here. As I looked down the panel, I sort of had an Admiral Stockdale moment, and I thought, who am I and why am I here? These folks are a lot more knowledgeable than I am. And then it hit me, David decided to hold this conference in a museum, and so I must be here as sort of an exhibit as to what an actual elected Democrat really looks like in Oklahoma. People in the back go, oh, really? That's what they look like. But I'll say this. We'll get into some of the meat and potatoes of this next legislative session here in a moment, and I'll be glad to answer some of those questions. But I'll give you my perspective on behalf of my House Democratic Caucus, the 29 of us. We go to work every day trying to do the best we can to move the state of Oklahoma forward. And our priorities this coming legislative session will involve education, public safety, and health care. It's nothing new, it's nothing earth-shattering or groundbreaking necessarily, but they're things that we believe are important to focus on. After you've heard of David's most recent budget presentation, you understand how poorly underfunded education is, how poorly underfunded public safety is. And when I say public safety, our caucus means public safety in a grand view, not just public safety in terms of how poorly funded corrections is or how poorly funded Department of Public Safety is, but also how poorly funded our schools are when it comes to protecting our students, whether that be from a gunman or whether that be from a tornado. Public safety extends beyond just your normal idea or concept of what public safety is, and it also extends from our perspective into police and fire, and whether or not we're going to have a pension system that's going to continue to encourage some of the best and brightest folks we have to come in and work in jobs that most of us won't work in, or whether we're going to reduce the benefit package for those folks and thus create a disincentive to bring in those people. So public safety will be on the forefront for us this session. And then finally, healthcare. When our hospital system in the state of Oklahoma absorbs anywhere between $400 to $600 million of uncompensated care annually, and we have rural hospitals in particular that are on the verge of bankruptcy, we have 1 in 5 Oklahomans without any health insurance. There's a real crisis in healthcare in this state. And so for us to take a budgetary approach that says we're $170 million in the hole, and then my colleagues in the House of Representatives say we need to double down on that and go ahead and cut income taxes even further, when we have significant needs that the state of Oklahoma believe should be met, I scratch my head, and my team know this. My team will work diligently, as hard and as loud and as vociferously as we can this next legislative session to protect the state budget, to invest in those core functions of government, and hopefully move Oklahoma forward and not backwards.
Thanks to all of our panelists for their opening remarks, and thanks for already answering half of my questions. But I will ask this first question is to Secretary Dorflinger. You know, we hear that the state's economy is generally better than, I guess, most states, or at least some states, but general revenue collections, as we've already heard, are predicted to be down, and they're running down this year, too. Secretary Dorflinger, you have mentioned recently that general revenue collections make up, I think, 50% or less than what we take in actual total tax collections. And, of course, the general revenue fund is what is used to fund state agencies and make appropriations. I'm assuming that's at least a key reason why revenues are in the general revenue fund are down. I will let you, is that a factor in the decline? And before I ask you this next part of this question, it kind of reminds me of my father was a gunner's mate in World War II, and one of his sayings was, you know, when dealing with issues or trying to make a quick fix on something, he would say something like, that's like trying to make a quick turn in an aircraft with an aircraft carrier. But I will ask you anyway, we have so much money being taken off of the top before it even, you know, is available for appropriation. How do you start that discussion even? How do you fix that?
Okay, I think I heard at least two questions. But you're right, and one of the things that we began to look at more closely was the amount of money that was being diverted to other things before it hit the general revenue fund. And just to review those numbers again, in 2007, members of the legislature and the executive branch had control of approximately 59% of the state's dollars for discretionary spending. As we move into 2014, that number is 48.1%. So I think the key word to that is flexibility, and that members of the legislature today and the governor's office do not have enough flexibility to address the needs of the day, because we have all these monies directed to specific things over a period of years. So to answer the other question of how you begin to unwind that, I think that's a great question for the representative from the House, Scott Inman.
Preston's right. You look at this year, because of legislation that was passed a couple of years ago as it pertained to the Department of Transportation, there's about $60 million new dollars that's coming off the top just to go to ODOT for roads and bridges. And make no mistake about it, I, like the rest of you who drive the roads in Oklahoma, understand that we need an investment, a continued investment in transportation in Oklahoma. It's a big picture. Education, healthcare, public safety, transportation, all of that factors into the equation in order to improve Oklahoma's environment, in order to bring people in. However, if we hadn't passed what passed a few years ago and said, well, this next $60 million is coming off the top and we have zero control over it, more or less at 23rd and Lincoln, we could take that $60 million new dollars and take a portion of that and give it to education, take a portion of that and put it into transportation and into a few other things as well. But we're unable to do that. Our hands are tied now because of that. And how you disentangle us from that, legislation can do that, but the problem is, as you well know, nobody wants to be seen as soft on crime, nobody wants to be seen as anti-public education, no one wants to be seen as anti-transportation. What will happen now, or what would happen now, is because that $60 million comes off the top, if, for example, we decided, if the folks who control our budget decided to come in and reduce the Department of Transportation's funding through the general revenue side, not the automatic off the top stuff, but reduce their funding side by about $50 million. Then we could take that $50 million out and give it to public education and other things like that. But in spite of the fact that they'd really still be getting a $10 million increase, everybody voting on the budget in the numbers would actually look like we're cutting transportation by $50 million. And that would be a non-starter among just your rank and file voter and amongst your rank and file House member. And so we've got to get a better handle on some of this money that comes off the top before we get into the rest of the budget.
Marie, if you don't mind, can I add one comment just briefly about this? This goes all the way back to the premise of the question, because despite what we've heard the last 18 months in the Oklahoma economy have not been all that great. We did wonderfully during the Great Recession. We outperformed the nation quite admirably for a number of different reasons, not all of them due to effective state policy, but just a lot of good luck on our part. We just weren't plagued with a lot of the problems the rest of the nation has. Then as the U.S. economy began to emerge from that Great Recession, the Oklahoma economy really took off. We had some really good years there for a couple of years, but in the summer of 2012, things began to stall. And so for the last 18 months, we have actually been kind of in a holding pattern. Part of that is due to just the state economy needed to take a breather. We had this incredible couple of year period where we just outperformed everybody, clearly. But we really have stalled in the last 18 months. Our unemployment rate is up. Our sales tax collections are flat. Income tax collections are down. The income tax collections, the general revenue fund income tax collections are down 11% compared to last year, so far this fiscal year. So it hasn't been all that stellar of a couple of years. And that's also confirmed by the data coming out of Washington. And saying that Oklahoma personal income in the third quarter ranked 36th in the nation in growth. And this makes the fourth consecutive quarter where we've been at or below the national average in personal income growth. So this is a challenging time for the Oklahoma economy, and that's what's led to this stagnating state revenue picture.
Thank you.
I want to add one thing to that. And I know Representative Inman will agree with me. If we don't take some of that money and make compensation for state employees a priority, we won't have anybody to build roads. So I just want to make sure I emphasize priority for compensation for state employees this year.
Thank you. This is for, the first part of this question is for Secretary Dorflinger. And, you know, we've heard more than once already this morning about the oil and gas industry tax incentives for deep and horizontal drilling and the potential cost of $300 million over the next couple of years. Given the state's continuing tight revenue situation, does that situation indicate a need to revisit those tax breaks and either let them expire or maybe change the tax rate?
Let me think. Again, I think I've been fairly vocal. When I first came out and suggested that they should be reexamined, I believe that was in July, and for 3 days I was in an undisclosed location in Bodo. I let that hang out there for a little while. There's no question that it needs to be readdressed, and I think that most of the members of the legislature, regardless of party, have an appreciation for the fact that that is the case. One of the things that I've been less, or maybe not as good at articulating, is the payback provision piece of the 2010 legislation. And the overall amount may equate to the same, but with the payback provision not in place, that's causing probably as much problem as anything. So I think as the members of the legislature begin to revisit this issue, that should be part of the conversation as well. But to answer your question very directly, there's no question that the governor has a position, and we have worked with the House and Senate up until recently, still working with the Senate, and the House has obviously staked out a different position, and when I say the House, the Republican leader, and you know, that's his prerogative to do so. I don't think anybody really believes at the end of the day it will remain at 1% and be made permanent.
Thank you very much. I'll ask him. I will ask you, what chance do you see for that type of legislation? You know, whether it lets the tax incentives expire or lowers the overall tax rate. What chance do you give that type of legislation in the House, particularly since Speaker Shannon has said that he will file, if he hasn't already done so, legislation to make the 1% permanent?
Oh, excuse me. I appreciate what Preston had to say. Our caucus is on the same page. We were a little taken aback and frustrated by what the speaker had to say. Our belief is that when you look around the country and you see what those drilling incentives are, or what the taxes are around the country, say in North Dakota, they're a little over 11%, and Texas is about 7%, and they're still drilling like crazy there. And you understand the fundamental nature of the credit the rate as it was dropped down to 1% was because at the time horizontal drilling was a new concept, and we wanted to create an incentive to encourage the industry to use that. Well, now it's gone from an experimental concept to that's the way they do business on a regular basis, right? And so I've talked with several leaders in the industry itself, and my caucus believes that we do need to take a good look at it. But we need to do it in a way that the governor and Preston and other folks are doing it. You bring everybody to the table, you negotiate it out, you don't come out and say, we're going to let it expire and go up to 7%, you all are just going to have to live with it, or you don't come out, nor do you come out and say, we're going to keep it at 1%, and we're going to keep it at 1% in perpetuity. That neither one of those makes sense to me. It's not good public policy. And so what I think, to answer your question, Marie, I think that there will be some sort of legislation to address it that may move it up 2 or 3 percentage points, something, who knows, that's for them to decide. I don't see it staying at 1%. I don't see it expiring and just allowing it. The governor's not going to allow it to go back to 7%, I don't believe. And so at the end of the day, while the speaker may introduce legislation to keep it at 1%, I don't think the governor would sign it. I don't think Senator Bingaman would allow it out of the Senate. My team certainly won't be supportive of that. And hopefully we'll get a good compromise come out of the Senate and sent our way, and that calmer, cooler heads will prevail on the issue.
Again, this is for Secretary Dorflinger.
David, you didn't say it was going to be like that.
thought we were friends.
Is this, and I'm reducing my questions, is this a, again, given the Supreme Court's decision last year on the income tax cut and the kind of current year funding for capital repairs, is this the session, a session when we need to consider a bond issue for repairing the capital and the other aging buildings?
So you ask all the questions that I'm not particularly bashful about. This is another place that I believe bonding is an appropriate way to handle these needs. And I think that it becomes more and more apparent as we look at the other needs across the state that this idea of pay as you go, and even though, and I'll be very, very honest about it, there was legislation passed through both chambers and we signed it as the governor's office. Sometimes it's okay to say, maybe that wasn't the wisest move. And with the Supreme Court's ruling, I think it gives everyone an opportunity to press the reset button and to reevaluate how we approach this from a policy standpoint. So far as the income tax reduction question goes, I'm going to tell you that the governor is always going to be a proponent of reducing income tax. What form that takes on, we have not had those conversations yet for this upcoming year. Again, a position that the speaker has staked out is pretty firm. But to Representative Inman's point, sometimes staking out positions doesn't mean that you get it passed through your chamber, through the Senate, and it lands on the governor's office and she signs it. I just hope that we continue to have reasonable conversations about these issues. But there's no question for me or this administration that bonding is an appropriate use and way to take care of some of our bigger infrastructure needs in the state.
And this question is for Dean Hebner. And we've kind of, talked around that certainly the edges of this, but, given the tight budget situation one more time, but there are some officials that are talking about an income tax cut, potentially this session, or doing, at least putting it in the hopper for this session. Given your understanding of the state's overall tax system, which includes much more than income tax, do you think that would be advisable?
Good God, no.
Okay, so.
No. Look, the first rule to solving problems is solve your biggest problems first. Right, and so even if you are a person who believes that we should long term look to reduce our state income tax, we have to admit that the data tells us that the income tax is not the most pressing problem in Oklahoma. Our income tax burden is again below the national average. We are a low income tax state already. If you want to cut taxes, the sales tax is a bigger issue because we're a high sales tax state. But we also have a number of pressing issues that require additional government funding. With education, healthcare, roads, prisons, the list goes on and on about the needs we need to address, about the problems we must face if we're going to provide our families, our children, our retirees, our citizens with the type of place that makes them want to stay here and live here, the type of place that they're proud to be a part of. We cannot keep doing that by continually shrinking government and starving government services. The most pressing problems we face are still in those areas of education, healthcare, roads, and prisons, not with income taxes. And so I would urge our legislature and our governor to start focusing on those more pressing problems that can truly make a bigger difference, a bigger impact on the lives of our families.
I'd like to add to the conversation that Dean Hebner just had, as well as what Secretary Dorflinger just said. When I talked about allowing for that gross production tax or the horizontal drilling tax to maybe go up through negotiations, we're supportive of that discussion. We may be supportive, our caucus is may be supportive of bond proposals because money's cheap right now. However, I want to make sure everybody understands that our position as a caucus on those two issues is such that we believe that there's, like as Dean Hepner said, there are desperate needs that should be met. Our fear, however, what we have to guard against is an attempt to say, well, we'll allow that tax to go from 1% to 4%, and we'll go ahead and take out bonds and take care of the state capital and take care of other things like that. And oh, by the way, now that we've done all of that, we can now go ahead and cut the income tax permanently, much deeper. That is a true fear that I have. And so what we cannot have that discussion saying, well, let's raise taxes here and drop them someplace else. Kansas did that. Kansas cut taxes dramatically, and they had a $1 billion budget hole. And how do they try to backfill it? They tried to backfill it by artificially maintaining an increase in their state sales tax, which is the most regressive form of taxation in society. That makes no sense to me. And I wish, as the governor told us for 2 years, we need to look to Kansas. I wish she would look to Kansas and realize that what they did was they helped out a few folks who pay a lot of money in income taxes and hurt everybody else who buys groceries. And I do not want to see Oklahoma go down that path.
I want to be, I kind of rearranged a little bit. I want to be sure and get this question because it's really important, and you know, what is done or not done impacts tens of thousands of people. This is for Sterling, and you've already laid the groundwork for and did it very well about the, you know, compensation study, what it said about salaries and benefits, and how I believe it said that benefits don't quite fully offset the salaries. And of course, I'll add this too. At the same time, there's been movement in the legislature the last couple of years to, and in the administration to get a hold on pensions and, you know, change pretty dramatically from the traditional pension system. And first of all, do you think is doing the pension part of it kind of putting the cart before the horse if the pension study, I mean the Safeway pay study is based on, you know, numbers from the current pension system?
I'm glad you asked the question, by the way. You know, the thing is we're trying to look at the compensation study and use that as a business model to compensate employees based on the private sector market. And I know there's a lot of press people here today, and if you want to Twitter and Facebook, and I encourage you because I want to make a statement. But I'm very disappointed in some of the legislators who think that you can reform pension and not deal with the compensation. And you can look at the Representative Rand McDaniel bill that was filed last night as a kind of a starting point of this. You know, we want to deal with one aspect of compensation, which is pay, salary, benefits, and things like that, but they don't want to deal with the overall arching compensation. And I'm telling you right now, the OPA is against a defined contribution, true defined contribution, because once again, it puts ownership back on the employee, while not dealing with the compensation, overall compensation. And we will not support a defined contribution, and I'm very disappointed in him for filing that bill. I will tell you, the governor's office and Treasurer Miller and even Auditor Jones, we've had some good conversations, because we do have some employees who want some portability within a retirement system. And here's the bottom line. It does not matter what pension system you have until they address the compensation of state employees. The pension system, just put it like it is, sucks. Because we have the lowest average employee, it's about $15,000 a year. We have the lowest retirement system as far as payout. And it doesn't matter what you do until they address the pay. You can go to defined contribution, cash balance, a hybrid, whatever it may be. It's not going to solve the problem until you address the salary. And it really disappoints me that some legislators do not see that. You need to address the salary before you start making benefit adjustments. And even the compensation study that came out, he says that he said you've got to address the salary before you start messing with the benefits. So please print that. We pay the defined contribution. And you can tell him I said that.
And this is for Dean facing a tight financial situation. Cities and towns are too. And as far as I know, all of them pretty much receive most of their revenue from the sales tax. And a lot of them are, you know, kind of advocating for taxing internet sales. And of course, there's always some discussion of that at the state and the federal levels. Do you think that would be a viable revenue generating avenue to pursue?
Yes, to the extent that we're allowed to under federal laws, and a number of states are working towards that. I'm a dean of a college of business by profession, but by training and by passion, I'm an economist. And one of the general rules of economics is that you tax similar goods similarly. And so you don't have these distortions in taxes. And so when I take my kids to Barnes & Noble, which is like a candy store to them, they go and pick out books, and we go to checkout, so they pay a tax on those books, right? And which they should. It's a tangible good, and so they pay a tax. A number of people go and you buy a book from Amazon, the same book, you don't pay a tax. Similar product, taxed differently. Violation of basic economic principle of taxation. But there's something else that the state of Oklahoma do besides just taxing internet sales. There are other types of products that we buy that are not tangible, that we don't pay taxes on because they're not tangible. My staff has learned not to give me pieces of paper when they want me to know information, because I'm going to give the paper right back to them. If they want to give me information, they put it in a PDF and send it to me so I can carry it around on this. Everything's electronic. All the books I read, all the books I buy, are on here. Carried around and read electronically. When I go buy a book from Barnes & Noble electronically, I'm not paying tax. I prefer to read it this way. Same company, not a tangible product. When I buy a $20 game for my son's Nintendo at Target, we pay a sales tax. I buy a $20 game for his iPad, no sales tax. Same game, different types of, same product essentially, different tax rates. And so I think Oklahoma has to look at modernizing our sales tax, one that reflects the purchasing behaviors of today's consumers. As an economist, I understand the benefits of a sales tax. I also understand the cost of it as well. One of the things we can do if we want to lower that tax on food is we can tax other products with a sales tax to broaden the base. And therefore, we could either use it to raise additional revenues or to lower the rate that we charge on necessities like food and clothing for our families. So again, the key thing Oklahoma needs to do in the coming years is modernize our sales tax.
I would like to thank our panel for